continue the school with the second tool today. It's by Leonardo Badia. Leonardo received his master and PhD in information engineering with honors by University of Ferrara in 2004. In March 2011, he joined the faculty of University of Padua, where he is presently associate professor. He's authored more than 120 scientific publications in international peer-reviewed journals and conferences, and he serves on the editorial boards of IEEE Transaction on Communication and Wireless Communication Letters. His research interests include wireless networking models for transmission protocols and the application of game theory to wireless communication. So he's today presenting something about how to give a talk, and a scientific talk and a presentation. So Leonardo, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Paolo, for the introduction. Can you hear me in the back, even? Everything's good? Okay, perfect. So today's presentation is about how to present a conference paper, actually. There are several kinds of presentation I might give. There are some general advices that will work also for them. But if you are going to give, I don't know, a seminar or a talk aimed at different things, rules can be different. So take this with a pinch of salt and adapt it to whatever you need to present. And also be aware that whatever I will say today is entirely my own opinion. It's by no means, I don't know, the gospel or whatever you believe in as the absolute truth. Don't think of this as fixed rules that you have to follow blindly. It's best if you adapt them to your own style of presentation. But generally, I would say this is derived with a scientific method, so by trial and error. So whatever I will say is because in my experience, I tried it differently, or I've seen people doing like this get a successful presentation. Okay? So the outline of the presentation is first how to prepare the document for your presentation. So I will discuss about the software you need to use and how to arrange the general theme of your presentation. And after that, I will discuss the more important part, which is how to put content in the presentation, which basically is generally structured into three parts. This is also true for most of your scientific articles you write. There is a background, motivation, state-of-the-art part. Then you do describe the real stuff, like explain the mathematics or the scientific part of it. And finally, you show some results. And this is a general framework you, I guess, you follow even in, in the text you write and also in the presentation. So I will more or less follow this track. Of course, there might be cases where you don't follow this because of reasons. You might have different numerical results you want to compare, so it might be more complicated. But in general, this works for 95% of the paper you're going to present. Okay, so first, let's discuss the preparation. How do you create your document, which kind of software you use, and everything. So it might seem strange, but actually I think that the best choice for presenting a paper is Microsoft PowerPoint, which for purists might be surprising, because purists think, okay, no, you should use the Beamer class of LaTeX or whatever else. But actually, there are good reasons to be skilled, at least in prepare a PowerPoint presentation. So this has been prepared with PowerPoint. Of course, you can use something else like LaTeX, OpenOffice, whatever you feel. In general, this is mostly for religious reasons, let's say. So you hate Microsoft so much, then you go towards some free software solution, which is fine, maybe. Or maybe your enterprise forbids you from using Microsoft PowerPoint. That can be another good reason. But in general, there are good reasons to use PowerPoint because it's the de facto standard. And those reasons are that it's normally available in every computer. So if you want to be portable, it might be that you save your presentation on a given computer and then you export it to another computer. Of course, you have to worry about portability, and I will discuss this later. Often, it might happen that you cannot use your own computer. You have to borrow a computer at the last minute because your computer is broken, or the establishment of the conference or the seminar, whatever, requires you to use a specific computer. So I save the presentation on my computer and I'm using this one, and PowerPoint is something that you generally find available everywhere. So you have to be careful and prepare it properly so that it is portable. Also, there is a very good thing for PowerPoint that is very easy to modify at the very last minute. So if you are like me and you finish the paper at the very last minute, and I have no doubt that sooner or later it will happen that you have to arrange a very quick presentation, then it's easy if you do it with PowerPoint. Also, it's easy if you merge contributions of different people. And since you are belonging to a collaborative project where you are supposed to cooperate with one another, then it is good if you ask them to work in PowerPoint. Because being plug and play, you can ask them, okay, this is the template, you just put your stuff into slides number 5 and 6, for example. Of course, if you know your collaborators and you know they are skilled in doing LaTeX, for example, then you can do this with LaTeX, fine. But generally, my experience tells me that is not always the case. So every time you force people to cooperate with something which is not plug and play, it becomes very hard, especially if you have some part done by non-technical persons who haven't never written a tech document in their life, or they are not used to different softwares. They use Microsoft softwares and the Office package as it is implemented in every computer, like my mom, for example. My mom thinks that the Microsoft Office is what you can do on the computer, nothing else. So then in this case, if you ask her to write a slide for you, it's easy if you ask her to write with PowerPoint. On the other hand, you can think that formulas do not show well in PowerPoint. Well, I will discuss this later. So there are tricks to do your math be decent, at least in PowerPoint. Okay, so the first thing, if you open a new document in PowerPoint from scratch, and the first thing you should set is the theme of your presentation. And what I advise you to do, and then you are free to do what you want, but I know that if you are using the default theme, like the black text on white background, nothing else, your presentation is going to be very boring. And since your goal is to present at the conference, you want people to remember your presentation somehow, so it's best if you have a theme you like that suits your presentation, and you stick to it whatever happens. When I say stick to it, is that you have, if you carefully plan it from the beginning, then you can fit the material you have to present in your theme without too much of an effort. Okay. So in this specific case, I'm using this theme. I arranged them from scratch. So just to show you that, well, if you have something which is you can remember, then it will be something you have in mind. So this kind of thing, this is the reason why you have this pink background and this marble black background in the end. So I will try using this presentation, which is going to be serious, but with this lighthearted theme. So let's see if I can stick to it. Of course, at the beginning, you might think this theme is good for my presentation. I can fit all my text, all my formulas, and you discover it's not. And then there is no harm in redoing things from the beginning. The thing is, the main problem is not when you are the master of the document. The main problem is when you integrate things coming from others, or when you recycle old material, which is something you're going to do sooner or later. At least when you prepare your PhD thesis, you're going to present something which is probably a merge of all your conference presentations, right? And to do that, well, generally you can do it very easily if you did think properly. But the thing is, the first presentations you generally give when you're a PhD student are not that good and that portable. So it's always always recommended that you check the presentation, and probably you spend more time rather than in writing new things, in adapting old things to the new presentation. This is very time consuming. So check your material first, because my thing, okay, I did everything properly, you present and you see that some formulas do not display, or some colors are entirely changed and do not match anymore the presentation style you gave. So this is something that is, unfortunately, something I have to do. And actually what I did, because of course in this material, in this presentation, I recycled some old material, so the most of the preparation I did was to check that everything was in place. Like, unfortunately, even though things are supposed to be portable, then they are not. If you use a different version of PowerPoint, it's granted there is something that's going to change. If some if the new computer has some fonts installed and some other fonts are not installed, then you have, well, something that goes wrong, so it's going to be very hard to manage. And that's just time consuming. There is no other way of doing that. The alternative would be to use a PDF presentation, but also that could be very hard to adapt, because unless you don't change any word of it, then it's going to be fixed, so you cannot change it and update it. Then you take your old PDF presentation, you discover a typo, and there are some ways of fixing it, but they are either expensive or they require some way around. So it's very difficult to manage them. So the best thing which I advise is to use your old PowerPoints, merge them into the new team, but check them before showing them. Okay. So what I advise you is to prepare your team in advance so that it is kind of portable. And there are some rules of thumb to know whether your team is good or not. The thing you can do, actually, because there might be no team you like, because maybe your PowerPoint has only boring themes, then you can edit your team. And instead of starting writing the document, you can arrange your team, edit your team, and save it and keep it like that. Actually, this is what I did here. I created a brand new team. There was no team with Pinkie Pie on it. I created it. Okay, you can do that. There are some, if you go in the back door of PowerPoint, there are ways of doing that. The thing is, this is generally true for any presentation you must give, but there are some suggestions specifically for scientific presentations. The first suggestion is to avoid anything strange, which means you immediately discard from your choice anything with diagonal text, because you're putting formulas in it, anything with some funny outline, because some funny outline is probably not going to be funny for you when you put the content in it. Also, some PowerPoint team have the title, which is not on the top of the slide, which is something I advise against, because you should have a general structure of title on top and text in the middle. Also, the thing is, if you want to be original, there are several ways of doing that. Maybe you just select a colorful pattern, a colorful palette, and that's good. That's enough. You don't have to be extremely creative. If your presentation is extremely creative, that's going to be maybe too much over the top. This is already a bit over the top, but this is not a scientific presentation either. So I wouldn't probably use this kind of theme for a scientific conference. Nevertheless, you can say, okay, let's have some colored background for the text, for the title, sorry, and some colorful palette. That's it, okay? There is another basic choice, which is some people prefer to use a dark background with some white text, and other people prefer to use the opposite. Well, for conferences, it's best to use a flat white background. So again, this, if you check carefully, this is not a flat white background, but this is not a scientific conference, right? So you see the background is kind of marble grayish and so, which can be used because, as the slide says, this is only for trained professionals, and I am a trained professional. But for the start, it's best to use a simple flat white background. And the reasons are formulas and graphs you must put into them. So we'll see later what happens if you don't follow this rule. So you can do that as long as you're confident that you can manage formulas and graphs, which are the weak points of a presentation without a white background. Also, dark backgrounds generally do not display very well unless you know the projection room in advance. So if you have to give like the last presentation of your PhD thesis and you know the classroom where it will be held, you know there is a good lighting and everything, that's up to you. But I generally advise still against it. Dark background presentations are good for like non-scientific presentation, like you introduce a brand new research theme without any formula, without any graphs, just with some fancy pictures from newspapers. That can be good. But in general, dark backgrounds are to avoid. Okay? Also, you should use a color palette. The color palette, you can set it in PowerPoint. It's also an important thing. There must be some good colors you keep, and you should use this to be portable. Because generally, if you, for some reason, you decide you have to give a presentation which is all in shades of blue, let's say, then you just change the palette, and this becomes according to the new palette. Of course, you have to check it afterwards, because still, some people like, I want to highlight this in red. And they set not the red from the palette, but they set the red color in the color menu. This will be red always, even if you change the palette. And that is something that you might want to avoid. So the best thing to do is to create a palette where you have a red color in it. And you have to be careful, because then if you change the palette, then the red color will also change. So it very much depends on what's the meaning of adding some red content, which is something also not to be done, actually, to add some red text. So the cheap trick is to create your own palette, and you might change it afterwards. So what I did here for this presentation is that I created a palette where I can even show you that I created a palette where, let's see if it works, if you have this, where is it, here, you see the palette of colors is this one, okay? So I used these colors I set so as to have some red, green, yellow and blue, and I set them. So if you change this, you can have, I didn't use the standard colors below them, I use the palette colors always. So if for some reason I want to change this, instead of having Pinkie Pie, I want to have it in normal red, green, blue with a more standard palette, you just change the palette and everything changes accordingly. Okay? So back to our presentation. The thing is, you should include some bright and variegated colors, but not too light. Actually, this projector is kind of good. Must be worth some euros. But generally, these three colors, like normal yellow, normal, well, lime green and cyan, never use them, because in some projectors, they don't display very well. So you just write something with this color, and it's invisible to the audience. So do not use lime green, cyan. Just use dark colors, possibly bright dark colors. And this is also important, do not use them for text. Just write your text in black. These colors are for highlighting things. But not, I generally advise against writing colored text, because that makes it harder to read. Okay? If you add some colored text, in a scientific presentation, what you want to convey is your text, mostly. Then you want to highlight it with your graphs and diagrams and everything. And that must be colored. But the text is best displayed in black, only black. Okay? Of course, this is, again, something subjective. But I definitely advise you against using this kind of pattern of colors in the text. So again, this is not a scientific presentation. But it's something you shouldn't do in a scientific presentation. Okay, also another thing is that there is a main problem in defining what the area where you put the text. So the free area where you write things. Okay, so you might think, I want a stylish presentation where I have a very big title area. And this is a problem because it gives you little space to write, put text in your presentation. Okay, so general advice is try to have a lot of space where to put content in the middle. This does not mean you have to use every single square centimeter of your free space. Okay, so one thing is to leave your option open, so to have a lot of space where you can put text, which is a good advice. The other thing is you want to fill every single square centimeter of your slide. Do not do that. Okay? So it is good if you have a lot of free space, like in this slide you have a lot of free space, but as you checked, I haven't used all of it. I don't write until the very last line of the slide. There is another problem that generally, if for some reason, if you start with putting content, you'll see that the free space, the text area, always looks so tiny. You always have some more content you want to put in. This does not mean the area is tiny, actually. This means you're putting too much content. Okay, so if you, for some reason, there is some content that does not fit the slide, I generally say, do not add this content. Try to find another way of putting it in. There is some design rule behind this kind of template they offer you. So I generally advise against enlarging the text area and putting everything up to the very border. Do not do that. The slide becomes too crowded. Also, you must watch out for university logos and such, because it's sloppy when they overlap graphs. If you have some, of course you have to put like the SCAVENGE logo on every presentation of yours. So be careful when you put it. And the problem is, if you go very close to the border, you prepare your presentation without any logo of the university or SCAVENGE or project or whatever. And then, but since you went very close to the border, then it happens that you have some logo like Pinkie Pie here, and there is some overlap, which is always annoying. It makes you think that, okay, this guy was so sloppy in preparing the presentation, they didn't even look that the text is going on top of the logo or vice versa. So either you can't read the text or you don't see the logo, it's always a mess. Okay, so the best thing is do not go close to the border, okay? Also, another choice you have to make is which font to use. Well, there is no right font, it's just a matter of taste, but if you use some funny, obscure fonts because you like it, then your presentation is going to be non-portable, which is bad. So, suggestion is stick to the most used fonts. Actually, you have three families of fonts. You might, this is very nerdy discussion, but you might know there are serifed fonts, sans serifed fonts, and there are also monospaced fonts like Courier Nu, and this actually used just to write pseudocode or something like that. So your choice is between serif versus sans serif. A serif is these tiny lines you have at the end of the letters. Okay? So serifed fonts are more formal, and sans serif fonts are easier to read. So the advice is generally to use, well, it depends. If your presentation is a standard conference presentation with some formulas and some text, my advice is to use one and one. And that's maybe the only occasion where you can mix. Generally are advised against using too many fonts. Like this is, let's see later, this already in this slide, again, this is not a conference presentation, but this is a bad example. There are four fonts in the very same slide. It's not a good thing. You see, it doesn't look good. Of course, it gives you the example of what a serif font is, but it's not very readable. Actually, If you want to be extremely formal, you can use a serif font throughout the entire slide. If you use a sans serif font, then that would be good for impact. It's easier to read, but it does not display very well the formulas. Okay, and finally, in whatever you do, don't use Comic Sans, because Comic Sans, for some reason, has the stigma of being used by people who want to be funny but aren't. So if you see, even though I gave you some example of what monospaced is, I didn't use Comic Sans to write Comic Sans because I don't want to use it. Okay, if you don't want any comment in your audience, say, oh, he used Comic Sans, he pretends to be funny, or he wants to be funny but he or she is not. So don't use Comic Sans. That's the simplest thing to do. Okay, so this is another example. So Times New Roman is something that's very serious. Actually, if you, as it's very likely, will copy and paste formulas from your paper, then you'll likely have something written in Times New Roman. So there is no problem using Times New Roman. In my opinion, it is a bit too much formal to have the entire presentation done in Times New Roman. It very much depends what your presentation. But if you want to go as a young researcher to a conference and show your findings, doing everything in Times New Roman probably is too much. On the other hand, the best font to use for being neutral is, well, Helvetica or Arial, as according to how you see it. This is very good in terms of impact. Actually, Helvetica has been designed to be very neutral. If you check most corporate logos, they use Helvetica because it's very easy to read. However, it doesn't do good formulas. If you try to represent formulas in Helvetica, they don't look well, because in formulas, you generally use serifs to better distinguish the terms. Like if you use Greek letters or you have some letters from formulas, mathematical symbols, they definitely look better with Times New Roman or something like that. There are also some curvy answers. The thing is that the Helvetica is very straight. This is why it doesn't display very well for formulas. Like the lowercase l is identical to uppercase I, also very similar to number one. So it's very easy to read, but it doesn't look very well for formulas. There are better unserifed fonts, but the problem is, well, you can do both. Maybe Lucida Sans goes well for formulas because there are all the mathematical symbols implemented in it, and they are better distinguishable. Also, Tahoma, Verdana are kind of good. The thing is, they require some effort to be used. And I would, maybe there are some few others, but do not go outside of this, because then it will be non-portable. So if you use other fonts than this, you can try doing both formulas and text with these fonts. That's a good thing, but you need some effort. Okay. And final advice is, do not use a slide with more than two types of fonts. And the only case where I allow you to use two fonts is because you have formulas and text, and use two different fonts for that. But do not mix, anyways. Okay? Okay, and finally, there is a big problem on how big should be your font be, and how much text should you put in your slide. So the general rule is, put the least text you can. Of course, the least you can, so that it is understandable what you wrote. Okay, try to compress the textual content of your slide, because your slide is not conveyed via textual messages, but via graphical messages. Okay, so if you just want some blanket rules, but those are really blanket rules, you must adapt them. But what I use to prepare a presentation is that I never use a font size below 30, well, never below 25, for sure. I generally start with font size 30, which might seem very big, but also the problem is you don't want to write too much. So this is a good measure I found, avoids you writing too much. Okay? And also, use fewer than 10 lines. Fewer means strictly fewer than, strictly less than 10, which means 9 or less. This is a very blanket rule, but still it works. If you have more than this, you can check, and if there are some usability guidelines advising against this. But nevertheless, try and see for yourself that with 10 lines, your slide is already too much full of text. And also, what I do generally is I start with this font size, and when you reach the bottom of your slide, then generally PowerPoint tries helping you fitting all the content. And they start squeezing your text, they compress the interline, they reduce the font size, so as to let you put everything you wanted. Well, you shouldn't let PowerPoint help you. You should help yourself. So the thing is, when the slide starts being too small for PowerPoint, it is not, well, of course you can live with that, but that should be the message: you should start a new slide. Okay? So the idea is, if you say, okay, I already ended, but I can put something else. So what I'll do is, I enlarge the border, I put some very small text so as to fit the slide. No, at this point, you should start a new slide. Here's the point, you should start a new slide. Okay? So interpret this as a sign that either is the moment to open a new slide and add some content there, or you have written too much. Okay? Okay, also you need some non-textual content sometimes. It can be of two different things. It can be a graph or a diagram, and we will discuss this later, or it can be some clip art you want to put to better illustrate your line of thought. Well, it is okay if it is illustrative, which is very rarely the case. Most of the time it's just a distracting element. So for this reason, I had tried several combinations of funny pink ponies, and I removed them because they were too distracting. So the idea is, if you have something like this, and you have some animation going background, and you try to see what I discuss here, you want to have some graphs and diagrams and clip art and comic strips. So now you're not paying attention to me, because you are just looking at the animation. So let's try better with removing the pony, and you see that the point is, it's okay if the non-textual content you have is graphs or diagrams to better illustrate your line of thinking, which is something that is very rarely the case, actually. I generally don't advise you to put some clip art of comic strips. It might look funny, but it's also very distracting. If you really want to put some non-textual element like that, you can put one per presentation, let's say, in a standalone slide. Do not mix it with text, because in my experience, if you put some, I don't know, Simpson strip or Dilbert, whatever, it looks very distracting. It's all depends on what you want to present. Sometimes I see presenters that really want people to be distracted because their presentation is really weak, and they don't want people to look at their math because it's faulty or they're not sure about it, so they put some funny animation on the side, so people are distracted by that. But if you really want people giving feedback about your scientific content, do not put this kind of animation. So the idea is, if you really want to have some funny comment or some memorable moment in your presentation, you can do something like that. You add something like this, and the thing is, you just do once. So, and think of it twice before doing it. Okay? Okay, so finally is to check your time again in the presentation. If you are talking about a standard scientific presentation for a conference, where you generally have around 20 minutes. Sometimes you have more, sometimes you have less, but well, you don't care because you are going to reuse the same presentation scheme, more or less. So it's just a matter of how much time you are allotted for questions and how fast you present the thing. The general thing is, if you want to be sure to stay within the 20-minute slot, plus, which also includes questions, do not prepare more than 15, 16 slides. No more than that, definitely. Because the idea is that generally in scientific talk, it's very hard to discuss one slide for less than 1 minute. It might seem strange to you, but it's very difficult to talk for less than 1 minute per slide, unless you really rush and it's not worth doing. Okay, so the first goal of your presentation would be to avoid going out of time. That's the first and foremost goal. Whatever you present, if you go out of time, you'll give a bad impression to your audience. So the idea is, well, but the thing is, I've done so many things, I want to present all of them. Well, the message is, here is, if you try to say everything that you did, probably 20 minutes are not enough, and then you're going end up in not saying the end part, which is the most important part, because they will cut your presentation off, so you will be forced to terminate, or you will do this very too much, too fast, or too much in a hurry, without focusing on the really necessary details. So try plan this from the beginning and avoid saying too much. Final suggestion is, in my experience at scientific conferences, actually nobody complains if you use less than your allotted time. If you finish earlier, like you take 18 minutes instead of 20, really nobody will complain. Nobody will say, oh, look, this guy just used 18 minutes. It must mean that his or her paper is really bad. It's not like this. It's more like if you are saving some time for the coffee break, the lunch break, whatever, which is what people care most at conferences, you're good. And the chairman will thank you, and so don't worry. Nobody will complain if you go below your time, but many will complain if you go beyond your allotted time. Also, in a sense, I will discuss this later, it's not a good thing for the other speakers if you steal their time. It's not really fair and scientifically honest. And for some reason, I also seen that those who go beyond their allotted time are generally not the best speakers in the conference. Okay, the thing is, every time I discuss this with my students, they say, okay, but yeah, I know you told me to prepare just 15 slides. But my presentation actually can be allowed to have like 17 or 18, is because it's a different presentation than everybody else, go figure. My presentation is different because my slides are very lightweight, so there is not much content, so I thought I can use less, more than 16. Or actually, yeah, it is 20 slides, but one is a title, another one is just thank you at the end, another one is just a comic strip. So it's really 16. Some other students might say, okay, this is, yeah, I know I prepared 22 slides, I could make fewer than 22, but you know, I thought I can just skim the slides. I go very fast through them and I will show the results very quickly. Also, some people say, oh, really, but I really tried. I rehearsed this at home and I did 19.55. Sure, I swear. So every time I hear this, I say, no, you go back and put less than this. You put 16 slides, 15 slides, I don't care. Because every time I hear this, in the end, it always turns out they take more time than a lot. Every time. Because for some reason, well, actually, if you have the title, you still invest some time in discussing it. If your slides are not so dense, this already accounts for slides not being too dense. Because that's something you have to do. I didn't tell you, okay, is prepare some very dense slides, and then if they're not so dense, then you can do more than 16. I said, don't do dense slides ever, right? And finally, if you just skim through the results, that's very bad. Don't do that. If you have some content, you plan to go through it quickly, that's very bad. Just skip it entirely. It's best not to mention it ever, okay? So if you do all this kind of reasoning, remember that you're doing a bad service to your paper, because your paper is not going to be properly presented, and also a bad service to the other fellow speakers that will hate you forever because you stole their time, which is not something nice to do. At least we try to be, in the scientific world, we try to be collaborative and scientifically honest, and this is one first step to make. Okay, so final thing that is always puzzled me. Actually, for small conference style presentation, you can even ignore this. But it's something that might be important. Should I put slides number in the corner, like here? You see, there is a slide number. Well, there is a good pro in having it, which is people can go to a specific slide if they have a question. They simply say, can you go back to slide number X? Which is good. And it's not something you want to do if you expect them to give you constructive feedback. If your presentation is very short, really very short, you can even skip this. That's the only pro you have. There are some cons. One big con is that generally in PowerPoint, these slides number are not very consistent. So you have to check the slide numbers do not go out of range. Or sometimes PowerPoint decides it's time to restart from number one for some reason. So check this. And finally, it's also distracting. Especially one thing I advise you against is to put the total number of slides or the progress bar. For some reason, the Beamer template, for example, does it by default. Don't do that. Because at least it's me, every time I see, oh, this guy is slide 17 out of 80 slides. Oh, come on. I can't wait for him to finish. That's what I think, always. But it might be me. Every time, so I generally advise against putting some progress bar, because like if I tell you that I have 99 slides today, which is actually what I have, but I won't show you all of them, is what you think. Okay, this guy is already only 19 out of 99. That's too bad. Okay. And also be careful when you have date, conference name, logos, whatever. That's even worse. Because generally, if you show up at a conference with the name of another conference, because you presented something, and then the next conference was more or less the same presentation, you could use some material at least. Then this is the best way to get caught with red-handed, because basically you have another logo, another conference name, that's very bad. So to do all the things around the slide border, check your presentation at the end. Also check the numbers are consistent, the logo is consistent, and everything. Okay? So this requires some time, unfortunately. Okay. Now I'm discussing instead the real presentation. This was kind of the introduction. So the general style for your presentation should remember this very rule of usability. I mean, my colleagues in usability research explained to me that the presentation is a double channel exchange. Well, you are supposedly all involved in communications, so you know what I'm talking about. You have two channels. One is the verbal channel, and the other one is the graphical channel. Okay. Always remember, these two channels should provide some sort of diversity. They should not carry out the same content. Otherwise, it's pointless. I have two channels. If I'm really good at explaining things verbally, why should I put things over there? The reason is to increase diversity of the message. And some psychology studies showed that people are able to learn more from double channel communication if the two channels are kind of independent. So if they read and listen to things at the same time, they improve their ability of learning things. If the two messages are kind of different, not entirely different, they are of course related, but they are not saying the same thing. By the way, this is one reason why the ATM machines or the automatic payment for tickets, they also tell you insert your card when instead of just displaying it, because for some reason they discover that this way people is more prompt in entering their cards. Okay, and the same you should do here. You should take advantage of this. So the general idea is you should prepare your speech so that it is similar to the content of the slide, but not identical. Because I guess the worst thing you can experience is somebody reading slides for you, right? That's very bad. Maybe you had some lecturer just going to the classroom and say, oh, okay, today we'll discuss general style. So presentation is equal to double channel exchange. That's very boring. And the best way of doing that is simply to have a graphical message. Of course, if you have a graphical message, that's the best way of doing diversity. Because a graph is something you display, and meanwhile you talk. So when you talk, of course you can't reproduce. There is no written text. That's the best way of doing that. Also, there is, remember that slides are also useful to read offline. So there is a difference in, even if you are extremely skilled in discussing things, and you can present it verbally, and the slide can be just there for show, still you want people to maybe save your slides in PDF format, or just read them, because maybe in the meantime they receive a call from family and they distract themselves for a while, and then they want to see again at the slide set and they want to recap where you are, So this must be the role of the text in the slide. Okay? Not to write everything, every single thing you are going to say, because that's what you should do in your mind. You even if you learn your lecture by heart, then you don't write it on text over there. You save it in your memory, in your personal memory, and instead you write the slide as a recap of what you're going to say. So people can realize that they are following everything. And also, if they go offline for a while, then they can have it at least with a permanent value. They're going to keep this. Okay? And this also gives you some guideline on how to set the content. This is why the slides should display well even when printed, not just for, and this is also critical for animation, as I will discuss later. Finally, remember that it's going to be you that is presenting the paper, not the slides that are going to present themselves. So do not rely too much on the slides quality. Of course, the slides should do their job, like being neat and clean and well organized, but you should have your organization even better in your mind. And this, actually, you will find that it's doable. If you prepare your slides with care, then you will be also more mentally focused and organized in discussing them. Okay, so another thing is about the laser pointer. As you see, Paolo said me there is a laser pointer here, but I'm not going to use it. No, there is a thing, but I'm not going to use it. And I advise you generally against using it, because there are many reasons not to use it. One thing is that it is very distracting, because if you have this pointer going around in your slides and you get distracted, as the animation before, you look at like a cat, you end up in looking at the bright red or green point on the slide. Also, there is a, well, methodological reason to avoid it, because it forces you to focus on a specific point. So if you agreed with my previous point that slides are useful for recapping things, so you, for a moment, you just look out of the window because you saw something, and then you want to pay attention back to the speaker, then you use the list, the bullet list, or whatever it is on the slide, just to understand where the speaker is at. But if the speaker is moving an annoying red dot on the slide, then he or she is forcing you to listen to that specific point. So it breaks the hypertextual form of the slide set. Also, yeah, it breaks the principle of double channel. Because if you have, as I said, two channels, one is the slide set and the other one is the speaker talking, and they should be almost independent, not entirely different, but they should be statistically independent as to maximize channel diversity. If the speaker is using the laser pointer, he's forcing you to get a correlation between the two of them. So it breaks this principle. Finally, if you don't have any laser pointer handy, you can still enter the slide set and use your own hand and do something like this. This actually works very well. It might be surprising. It depends, of course, on the auditorium you have. If you have a big auditorium, you can't really point things with your hands. But there is another reason. If there is something that is really important, it should be already highlighted, so that first people can also understand it is important when they're reading the slides offline, which is something they can't do with the laser pointer, right? And finally, if there is something that is very important, you put them somehow implicitly highlighted in how you arrange the text. And final reason is that it's very annoying when people ask for a laser pointer at the conference. The laser pointer is never working, and then it runs out of battery, and then the presenter is kind of lost because he planned to use the laser pointer. So if you are in this situation, then you will think twice before using a laser pointer again. If you are relying on a laser pointer and then the laser pointer runs out of battery in the middle of your presentation. Okay. So final tips for presentation is, well, I generally advise you to check the audio before starting, because some presentations actually advise not against checking the audio before starting. You should start directly, which is also a good rule, but for a scientific presentation you don't want to sell things, you just want to be sure that people understand your message. So in this case it's best to ask people if they can hear in the back and everything. You check, also you can see by yourself, but just starting a presentation where nobody listens to you and they ask you to speak up or check the mic is very annoying. So I generally advise you to check the audio before starting. And also, you should use eye contact. You should look at your audience. Even though it looks like, I know, at the beginning you'll be shy and you see these old professors in the front row. Well, not the case here, but in conferences you see old professors looking at you. Oh, what is this guy saying? I want to destroy him. They look like that, but they probably, in reality, they probably don't care about what you're going to say. So don't worry about that. It's best to look at them in the eye, and you might, I don't know, there are tricks to do that, like you just look at their eyebrows, something like that. It works. And another thing that seems silly, but for some reason inexperienced speakers tend to do very often, is to point at the desk screen. So now I am not even looking at the screen, but if you have a screen in front of you, they're trying to see, okay, as you see in this line, for some reason I found that inexperienced speakers tend to do that a lot. So don't do that, obviously. It seems kind of obvious, but it's better to know this in advance. And also avoid stepping in the beam unless you do it intentionally. So if you want to highlight something, you want to say, okay, this point says that you shouldn't go inside the beam, that's good. But if you, okay, I think the room is very well organized, but generally in universities you have a projector set up in some strange way, and it's very easy that you're, I don't know, you go like this and you go all the presentation with half your head and in white, and it's very confusing because people look at you and they don't take you seriously. So try be out of the beam, okay? And finally, be yourself. Of course, this means you should be interactive with the audience. Remember, you are not neither better nor worse than everybody else in the audience. Generally, in scientific conferences, the good thing about the scientific community, there is a peer-to-peer relationship. Even the oldest professor with a lot of experience can learn something from you and vice versa. So don't worry about discussing things. It's a really, the really enjoyable aspect of a scientific discussion is that it is a discussion among peers. So be friendly with everybody. Don't be scared. Don't be even arrogant either. Just be yourself. Okay, as you were discussing things with friends, because after all, in the scientific community, I like to think that we are all among friends and doing a nice scientific discussion from the, well, good being of humanity, whatever you think of. Okay? Okay, now let's discuss how to put things in the presentation. And as said, there is a threefold structure. First, you discuss the background motivation, then you explain things, and finally you show the results. And I will discuss all three parts. Besides these three parts, there is some packaging, title, outline, question and answers at the end, which also steals space. So you should count this into your budget. Okay? All these three parts use a double channel communication, but the setup is slightly different because, of course, you don't use the slide channel in the same way for the background, for the explanation, and for the graphs. Okay, how to put the content generally? As said, you should use simple sentences, the simplest you can. And you should use impact sentences, which means do not put the entire sentence with every grammar element. Like, you are free to break English rules. You are free to avoid subjects, to use even shorter forms, verbal forms of words, whatever. It's not very formal. The important thing is that it must be direct at the audience. Okay? So do not worry. Well, of course, you should not be sloppy. You shouldn't be like break grammar rule and write wrong subjects or wrong verb conjugation. That's another thing. But do not worry too much about putting every single element. Like here there is some, well, elliptic sentence without verb. It's okay, as long as it's kind of correct. And another rule that, well, this, it very much depends, but with, for some reason, Northern European speakers tend to be very insisting about this, do not put two concepts in the same slide. So do not, if you have, a slide should be devoted to a specific single concept. Of course, there might be subparts, but do not mix different things. Otherwise, certain kind of speakers, especially I was discussing things, that's apparently is a general rule they teach you in Germany and other Nordic countries. They tell you, oh, do not ever do that. That's a capital offense, apparently. So do not do that either. And if you want to see other suggestions, I think there is a very funny slideshow, PDF slideshow available online somewhere. You just Google how to give a bad talk. It's very sarcastic. It gives you very, very good rules on how to give a bad talk. So, of course, I advise you not to follow them. But if you check, you can Google this, and you'll see a lot of common mistakes done in presentations. Okay. So, first point before going to the three levels of organization is, do I need to use, let's say, overhead slides? So organizational slides, like the outline at the beginning, and maybe intermediate slides to recap the level of discussion you are in. Well, it depends. It depends on your style. In certain cases, they are irrelevant because they don't convey any information content. It's really like the channel coding here. You do channel coding not because you want to convey more information, but because you want to improve the understanding of your information you already have, right? So here you do the same. In reality, for you it might be obvious, but for people in the audience, it might be useful to have some recap points, some intermediate points where you say, okay, this section discusses this, this other section discusses that. Also, it helps you too, because if you have some outline at the beginning and some intermediate outline, it helps you make up your mind on what you're going to say. So in a sense, it is not entirely pointless. Of course, it is useless for adding more content. So weigh it carefully. Do not do a presentation with a lot of overhead without any actual content. Because my other advice in this respect is to count these outline slides in your 15, 16 slide budget. Okay, do not say, as before, if you remember, I said not to think, okay, yeah, it's 20 slides, but 5 of them are just overhead slides. So it's actually 15. Wrong. If you check, you're going to spend more than 20 minutes for that, if you have 20 slides, no matter what kind of slides you have. Also, if you have organized slides, you generally want them to be not too crowded. So very simple points. You distinguish them. Of course, in general, you don't have crowded slides ever. Don't crowd your slides too much. But these overhead slides should be even less crowded. Okay? And you want to have some fancy effects, like this one, you see? This one is commonly used. If you want to add that for some reason, you should prepare this at the end. The difficult thing is that there is no way of doing that if not preparing two slides, one with the text great and the other one with the text really dark. And so this is something you do at the end. So it's like icing on the cake. Do not waste time at the beginning. First organize the content and then afterwards add your overhead, which means you need to prepare something in advance. You can't do this at the very last minute. It will go awful. Okay, so first part of the scientific description instead, apart from this overhead slides, is the background of your presentation. And this is actually very important. If you are going to give a scientific talk, the first objective of yours should be to hook your audience, to catch your audience and to let them pay attention to you, because you're saying something important, relevant, interesting. Okay? More than, this is something that people will remember more than the actual content. Because unless they work specifically on that topic, if you just increased the upper bound of this well-known problem by epsilon, they'll say, oh, I saw a presentation where this smart young guy from the SCAVENGE project improved by 1% this bound. That could be a good result for a small fraction of the audience. But the rest of the audience, all they will remember is I saw a nice presentation by a guy from the SCAVENGE project discussing a way for improving energy efficiency. Okay, so this is something you must convince your audience is an important problem. After that, then the specific numerical result is something that comes later. But do not underestimate the need for convincing people that your problem is important. It's actually more important than showing that you did a very good job. So for this reason, you should outline the technology overview of your problem. So what is the technological context of your problem? Because if you just start discussing, oh, I improve energy efficiency, of what? Of which kind of technology? You must say that. And also you should give some sort of motivation, inspiration. Why did you do the job? Why did you evaluate this task? If applicable, you should also describe related work in the area. This is actually tricky because it is very important for seminars. But if you say, I extend this very well-known bound, it's very likely that this very well-known bound will be very well-known just to two people in the audience. And nobody else will know what it is. So if you rely on an important contribution made in the literature, do not assume people know it. So you should better say, OK, there is this important bound that states this and that. And in this paper, we improved it by a bit, okay? And finally, you should also describe which kind of scenario are you focusing on. All of this, of course, you should do compact in doing that, because you can't really do this a single slide for everything. But you should give an idea to your audience of what your talk is about. Because that, again, is what they will remember. I've seen so presentations which were very well remembered by people because they did this very well. They focused on a specific scenario and they did it very clearly, so it was good for them. They were able to let people understand what the paper is about. On the other hand, I've seen very good presentations where they demonstrated some important proof, where they didn't explain to people what their problem was about, and so some people understood in the audience, but many people say, oh, well, looked interesting, but I didn't understand what it's about. Of course, this part should be conveyed, every part should be conveyed with a graphical setup, because if you remember, the best way of exploiting the double channel is to do things graphically. Well, to do this graphically is actually quite easy, because you just show them some pictures of your technology, you show the scenario graphically. Is actually very easy to do. You can use pictures find on the internet. Just Google them and you are good to go. It's best, you can think, okay, but that's stupid. It's a scientific presentation. Why should I Google a picture and put a picture showing a smart grid system, for example? Well, this is much better than adding a wall of text, definitely. Believe me, people, I know it sounds silly because either way is not really scientific. But instead of doing a wall of text, which nobody will read anyway, just put a nice picture. If what you want to convey is that we focus on this kind of scenario, okay, then a nice picture will do. Okay. Also, it is important, as I said, that your slide, the very first slides, are catchy. You convince people that the problem is relevant. And to do so, you should be very charming and convincing. So to do so, you should use nice, bright pictures. Do not use, use a picture, but if your picture is like grained or low definition, an enlarged low definition picture, say, oh, come on, this is so ugly. So search for a big picture with high definition and whatever. Also should be bright and convincing. And the objective is to show the audience that your problem is somehow important. So, for example, a good way of doing that is something that Paolo did in the first presentation, showing that there is a surge in world need for this kind of technology. Like some very often said figures like the number of computers or cellular phones or the energy consumption is increasing like that. I say, oh, really, I didn't know that. Like 70%, whatever number, even if it's not accurate, that's the point. The numbers can even be used, in this case, in a non-scientific manner. But if you, of course, use the right number, but the point is not the precision of the number that makes the message. Okay. The point is you have to convince people like that half of the world population is now connected to the internet and growing. And nowadays there are more cellular phones than human beings on Earth. This kind of indicators is very catchy. Okay. And finally, you should also describe to the audience what you will talk about. Because from the title, they might expect either a very methodological presentation on some theorems you show, or a very overview presentation. It can be everything. So you should explain this at the beginning. If you're going to discuss things from a tutorial perspective, you're just giving them an overview of the technology, or you're presenting them some specific results in a specific field, something like that. Okay. And finally, you should be, well, charming if you can. You should try to catch and captivate the interest of the audience. Okay, now let's see the explanation part. So when the real content comes in, because this is a scientific presentation, you should explain things in a scientific manner. Okay, so to explain what you did, the contribution of your paper, that's very hard to do because you tend to be using formulas or math, because that's what you did. So you did a pseudocode of your algorithm in your paper. Okay, so I simply copy and paste it. Wrong. So bad. Don't do that. The things you must avoid at all costs is to copy and paste your math or your schemata, whatever, from the paper. Most of the times, it's time consuming, but you should do an entire rewriting of that part for your presentation. Of course, that's all depends on the time you have at your disposition for doing this kind of things. But remember that if you just copy and paste your formulas, that will be very, very lazy. So don't do that. Also, it very much depends on what you think the audience will be able to understand in the short span of 20 minutes. Probably they won't be able to follow all of your mathematical derivation. So don't do that, with some few exceptions, which I will mention later. The best way, so also the other way is, okay, so I don't put formulas, then I write a very long text. Don't do that either. Don't put a longer textual explanation. That's bad. If you can do that, that's the best way of explaining this, would be to use diagrams, colored diagrams possibly, with some, if you have time, serious animations. Animations are a bit of a problem because they can be useful for a conference, but they don't display in the printout. So be careful also with that. But the best way of letting people, and also they are very, very much time consuming. So use them sparingly if you are able to manage them quite easily. But otherwise, you should use a nice colored graphical diagram of your contribution. For example, I remember I've seen a very nice presentation I've seen in my life was a presentation about information theory, where they showed something like an improvement of some bounds. I don't even remember which bounds it was, but it was explained so nicely because they basically did some turns. They didn't show any formula at all. They just showed graphs, Cartesian diagrams, with information channels and mutual information of receiver destination. And they highlighted some contributions in red, green, blue. And in the end, they showed up how they summed up to some jigsaw puzzle in an animation. So it was nice because they were able to understand what did they do in the paper. If you really wanted to know what the contribution was, you had to read the paper, which is also good because that's your objective. Another objective of yours will be, apart from presenting the paper and get done with it, would be also, otherwise I don't publish the paper in the proceedings, which is good. But also another objective of yours is that people read the paper, maybe cite your paper, and you are able to interact, because again, they give an improvement over your bound, then you give an improvement over theirs, and so on. That is a good objective you might have. And to do so, you don't really want to explain every single detail of the paper in the presentation. That's impossible. It's much better if you're able to convince people to read your paper afterwards. Okay? Okay, so the thing is, this is the greatest difference between this kind of presentation and a seminar, because I mentioned at the beginning, this kind of advices work well for a conference presentation. In a seminar, of course, you are allowed, and you're even maybe requested to go through the details of your mathematical approach. But in a conference presentation, there is definitely no time. Plus, people are listening to, five speakers in the same session. They really aren't focused on your presentation. They didn't come maybe to the presentation to listen to yours. Maybe they were attracted by another presentation. So you have to be catchy and convince them that your problem is relevant. Okay, so if you just show them some mathematical formula, that's definitely the opposite of interesting. If you just show some optimization problem, analytical derivation, that's wrong. Don't do that. Well, there are some reasons to do that, but I'll tell you about this later. The thing is, people can read the paper, and you shouldn't use that as an excuse not to have any mathematical content at all, because you say, okay, since you don't understand what I have done in 20 minutes, I don't explain any. You should try to explain something, but only the interesting part, which might be very difficult to convey. The thing is, what is more interesting for just casual attendees to a conference is what kind of problem you solved, you addressed, and what kind of methodology you used. And you should tell them what's new of your approach. Because if you are able to convince them you did something new, something original, that's a plus. Okay? So they should go home without the understanding of every detail of your formulas. That's impossible. But they should go home with some memory of what you did in the respect of a specific problem and which kind of contribution did you do. This is doable. So this is a reasonable objective and should also be your prime objective. Actually, there are some instances where you want to show equations because the metaphor is that equations are like popcorn muscles. By popular muscles is a way of saying those people like the Governator Arnie that are so pumped and beefed with muscles that they look like they're swollen like a popcorn. Okay, this is, depending on how you look at it, some people say, oh, I like, very nice. Other people say that's ugly. It depends, it's a matter of taste. But certainly they are impressive and you won't bother somebody with popcorn muscles, right? So the same thing, if you show some good wall of math like this, which actually, by the way, some of you might remember is a formula But the last one is a formula in channel correction. And the other is one a paper of mine. So if you have a formula like this, for sure, you won't bother asking questions. Even though the formula itself is actually quite, I chose this formula because the formula is actually quite simple to explain. In the presentation, we didn't explain like that. We didn't show the formula at all. The formula is actually quite stupid. But you might want to show the formula, so say, OK, look, see, I did a lot of math. That's the point. That's the only reason to show something like that. So if you want to impress your audience, which is something you might want to do, you just show them for a glimpse and say, OK, look, we are good mathematicians. We did this. But then if it's the only thing you show about the paper, that's very disappointing. It's OK if you show them some mathematical contribution, explain in a graphical form, and then you might want to convince them there is some math behind. It's just, it's not like you did just colored blocks put together. Okay, good. But that's the only way I suggest you doing that. And you might even skip this part entirely. It's up to you. It's a matter of style. Okay. Also, there is another thing that not only equations are very boring, even for, well, of course for the average people, but even for conference attendees, believe me, they're also very difficult to read. So I think nobody of us is a native speaker of English, and it's very annoying when you hear some mispronounced Greek letters or operators. So here I put a link of a tutorial from the Helsinki University where they explain to you how to pronounce every single. It's very difficult, actually, because it's something even native speakers maybe don't do it properly. So it's very difficult to read a formula. And also, is always ambiguous. There is no way it is univocal. It's always difficult to explain, like, you have x1, y, what does it mean? It's x to the power of y and subscript 1 or whatever. It can be something different things, and it's very difficult to read. So best thing to do is avoid putting formulas, so you don't have to read them. Of course, sometimes you have some term, so be careful you are pronouncing correctly. Like, I don't know, Italians always say, like, this last letter there is not called Y, it's called Epsilon, of course. And I think other people do that too. Don't do that because that's confusing. That's Y, and so on, okay? And for Greek letters, it's even worse. So if you have some formula like this, I have no idea of how to read it, even though this is another formula about the Hamming distance of something, some code. I don't think there is a way of reading this. It's best looking at it to say, oh, good. Nice formula. That's the only way I think you can read it. Okay. The thing is, if for some reason you really need an equation in your presentation, the suggestion is to write them big, to put just equation with some very few comments. Do not put like it is in line in the text. That's impossible to read then. Also, be sure that the symbols are easy to explain. Because it might be that you need to explain some symbol because your numerical results heavily rely on the symbols. Then this is also a good reason for you to put easily readable symbols in the paper, because then you have to present them afterwards. So avoid things like, okay, in the paper you are allowed to put a dense formula with a lot of symbols, and then in the line below you write, okay, where alpha is this, beta is that, gamma is this else. In the conference you can't really present like this. So you have to use symbols that are self-explanatory, sort of. So you have to be remembered by the audience if you really have to use them. So also, the meaning of the symbols is something you explain. So do not put, of course, you do not put the list of the legend of the symbols. And to explain them, it helps if they explain themselves. Like, you can call an error probability whatever. Like, you can call it x, y, whatever. But if you call it, epsilon, looks easier for people to understand that epsilon is connected to errors. Okay? And finally, if you show some formulas, if you really have to, do not show all the mathematical steps. Just show the original part of it, highlight the end results, and show why your formula is important, because maybe you changed something that matters. Okay? How do you create equations? Because the point is, you have to plug in some equations. And this is a matter of taste. Well, there are three ways of adding an equation in your PowerPoint, let's say. One way is to use a dedicated editor. Another way is to write text with some tricks to resemble the equations. And final version is to cut and paste from PDF. Actually, there are other editors, like LaTeX-like editors, that allow you to derive, well, in the end, they will produce a PDF. So it's like step three. In the third version, you still have to cut and paste a PDF produced by some software. Okay. So the difference is between a plug-and-play add-on, just writing text, or copy and pasting something from PDF. Well, there is, all of these three choices have pros and cons. It depends very much on the level of mathematics you have in your paper. It's really an engineering trade-off, and the real difficult thing is to be portable. So this is a list of pros and cons. If you use some dedicated editor, like Equation Editor or MathType, they work well because they're plug and play, so you can edit them. Of course, they are not very portable. I tried, for example, by simply copying this from Mac to Windows, the equations look different, and also they were different to edit, so it's not very portable. It might even be that you prepare your equations with Equation Editor, and the PowerPoint at the conference does not have Equation Editor, so wrong. And you see some missing plugin sign, which is not good for presenting. Okay? Another way of doing things, which I use very often in my game theory course, actually, is to use text. And this, of course, you can do if your equations are very simple. Game theory equations are simple. They are just one line without many fractions or square roots or other terms. If so, this can be done. Of course, the advantage is you can edit them, because they are just text inside the normal text. There are problems because they require effort. To write a text that resembles an equation, it's maybe much more time consuming than using a plugin, of course. And also, it is sort of compatible. You have to use very simple fonts. This is why I mentioned earlier that if you use basic fonts, like Helvetica or Lucida Sans or something like that, there you have also mathematical symbols available. If you use some fancy fonts with just the Latin alphabet and no Greek letters, then, or not even square root symbol or parentheses or whatever, then you can't use them for writing formulas. That's a problem. Also, it can be somehow not very portable. It depends. Sometimes, depending on the computer, these fonts change a bit. And final version, which is probably the most common, is to cut and paste from PDF. You just take the formula from your article and copy and paste it into the presentation. This is very quick. Sometimes goes even very nice, because like it's what I did in the previous equations. I also had arranged some alternate. I wanted to show you how Equation Editor works, but actually in this, I didn't know, and maybe there is no compatible Equation Editor in this computer, so I didn't put it, because it might well be that it's non-compatible and you don't see anything. This is the best way of making them portable, of course using PDF, but you cannot edit it. So if for some reason you recycle your presentation because everything is identical but the formula, then you have to write the formula again. It's very difficult to manage, right? Also, it might have a different font. It's generally in Times New Roman. So you have to be sure that your presentation goes well with Times New Roman, okay? This is the same thing if you use LaTeX editors, because if you use LaTeX editors, anyways, in the end, you're going to have a PDF that is to be cut and pasted into the presentation. Okay, so that's just an objection I received. Okay, but what if I use LaTeX for PPT? Well, same thing. In the end, it boils down to copying and pasting a PDF, which is doable and nice, but also, to translate your explanation into something graphical is very time-consuming. It takes a lot of time to arrange everything you did in graphical form. But there are some advantages in doing that. First of all, in the long run, it's very helpful because it gives a very nice way of explaining things to the audience. So at the beginning, it's very time-consuming, but after 2-3 presentations, you get more skilled in doing that, and then you don't waste so much time. Also, for some presentations, you do it only once, because in the end, after you did some explanation, then you, in the next paper, you did some change in your approach, but most of the graphical part stays the same. If you want to explain which kind of problem did you explore, then you do only once. Okay, so for the first presentation, and then for the second, you recycle material. And also, you don't need to be very detailed in that. You can keep it simple. Okay, so really, for doing a mathematical explanation of that with some diagrams and everything, you don't need to be very accurate, very precise. You will see that even a simple explanation is worth the effort. And also, I must add, this also improves your own understanding of the problem. Okay, so the thing is, you might be tempted to do that for every proof in your paper, some full detailed explanation. Well, you can do that if you need it, but generally it's useless for a conference presentation. So should you do the entire derivation of your entire approach in your PPT file? Yes, actually. The thing is, you don't show them always. You show them only upon request. This is, so you should be prepared to have some backup material that is shown only 10% of the times. Most of the times, you prepare a lot of things and you don't show them, and you feel sorry for that because, oh, I waste my time. Actually, you didn't, because first thing is useful to improve your understanding. If you prepare some backup slides with some technical description, explain it graphically, that is very useful to improve your understanding, actually, of the problem. And also, if you give a seminar about that, then it is good to give a detailed talk. And finally, it's the best way to answer questions. If there is a question about that, then for sure, if you show them the backup slides, it looks amazing, because it looks like you prepared the question and answer. It happens only rarely, though. Okay. So I think I can show you this slide, and then we stop for the lunch. The thing is, how deep should you go into the explanation level? Well, it very much depends on how smart your audience is, because certain audiences might be very deep into the problem, so you don't need to be, you can skip some details. For other audiences, especially for a general audience in a conference, you must be very detailed. Okay, so the suggestion is that generally at conferences you think you have the smartest guy in the world, actually they are more or less smart like, well, not a kindergarten, but some elementary school student. So you should be very, very simple. Because, yeah, they are smart, but they work on different topics and they don't understand the thing. So imagine of explaining things to like a elementary school kid. The thing is, if you explain things too simply at a conference, I mean, if you keep the level of explanation very simple, nobody will complain. Actually, they will be proud that they understand the thing. So give them satisfaction and they let them enjoy the talk if you keep it things simple. Okay. Of course, you have to check the time, because to explain, strangely enough, but it's not that strange, if you try to explain things very, very simply, you are going to be longer than explaining things in a complicated manner. So be aware that it requires time. So carefully balance your time for explanation. Okay? And this is something I will discuss after the break. Okay, guys, are we ready to restart? Can you hear me again now with the mic? That's good. Okay, so we were discussing about the explanation of your content. And another thing you might want to do, which is both a blessing and a curse of PowerPoint, is animations. Animation can be, if properly done, can be very useful because they explain things in an interactive fashion. However, they are very difficult to do, to be properly done. So they can be fun also, but can be very distracting. So it very much depends on what you want to animate. Especially if you have some animation, it's very difficult to keep the right pace. You have to be careful to plan them in advance very precisely. Because if the animation starts and you're not ready to explain what it's showing, that can be very problematic. So also you have to check them, rehearse them, so be careful. If you manage to do them properly, they can be very useful. The other problem of animations is that you should prepare slides that look good even in print. And this is very difficult because if you have some animation, they won't show up in printing unless you plan them properly. So especially one thing you shouldn't do with animations is to overlap content. So don't plan some animation that ends up in covering some content, because then this one will be visible in printouts, unless you do some trick like that. So one good thing to do would be to use transparency. If you overlap transparent things, then you can understand, like here, that this content is crossed out, but still you see it behind. And another trick I recommend you is to check the printed version. One way that you can add comments replacing animations is to add some invisible comments. So the idea is, you can add some contents that show up only in the printed version. And this kind of content can be visible when printed. You don't need it when presenting because you have the animation instead. Okay. One cheap trick is a trompe-l'oeil kind of thing, which is you add some contents in the PowerPoint and you set up the animation to disappear as soon as the animation shows. So as soon as the slide starts, you set PowerPoint to make them disappear. So they won't show up ever, basically. But you have them for the printout. So if you check this printed version, if you check the PDF version of this presentation, there will be some content that I added, which won't be visible in the animation, in the presentation version, which is pointless to show you like this, but it's useful because it replaces some animation. Okay, and the last part of the technical content you should put is actually probably the most important, is the quantitative things. So something that shows numbers, real things, science. Okay, because up to now it's all about, okay, the problem is important and your audience understood that. Also, they understood what kind of methodology to use, but in engineering it's all about the numbers. So in the end, you need to show that you did something good. Like your method is better than the other alternatives you have, or you did some good approximation, or whatever you did is good. Okay? And you must put some numbers even like that. You kind of understand this is good. And this is the top message to use graph for. So this is the most important part where you should avoid words and let the numbers speak by themselves. So do not use tables to do that, because tables are already bad for articles, but they are especially bad for presentations. You should do the effort of doing things graphically, because they convey much more visual meaning. And this can be, if possible, a Cartesian chart. If not, at least use some histograms, pie chart, whatever. Do not use tables. Also, another common mistake when displaying graphs is to put some graphs and some words beside the graph, which is wrong, because if you remember, you need a double channel. So the words is what you utter, what you say with your mouth. So you don't need these words written in the slide. So this is, in principle, a bad slide, because you see a very small graph and some text around it. What's the need for this text? The graph should be, first of all, self-explanatory, and also should be big, so people can see it properly. So the thing is, do not decrease the size allowed to your content by adding some words. Words is something you say. Final thing is, this is where the background problem comes into relevance, most likely. Because if you do like this, this, you see, is supposed to represent a slide where you have a dark pink background and you put some white graph on top of it. So this is ugly to see, because you can wonder, why does this presenter choose a pink background if his or her graphs are all on a white background? Then the best way to avoid this is to use a white background also for the slides. Or if you check carefully, this is actually, well, I don't know if it's visible, but the background of this graph is actually the same as the slide, which is not flat white. There is some pattern. So if you are able to do your graph with a good quality and high definition, and you can make the background transparent, that's also good. But still, that's another reason to use some light background, because still, if your graph is going to be like this, I mean, a dark pink background won't display some curve. So either the simplest solution is to use a flat white background for everything. If you want, you can use a non-white background, as I did, actually. But you have to check that your figures can be made with a transparent background, and they also display well on the, like, gray background they have here. Okay? Otherwise, it's really ugly, and it looks like, okay, this guy didn't even think of properly displaying his graphs, which are the most important part, the part where you spend concentrating most of the attention to your topic. Okay, so this is how you should have your graph, like just a graph and the title. So if possible, all the information about the graph should be in the title. Also, because if your graph is properly made, it should be self-explanatory. So this is actually not a part on how to give a presentation, but a general advice on how to arrange a graph also for your paper. Your x-axis, your y-axis should be self-explanatory. People should know what the graph represents just by looking at it. That's a general rule, actually, not a rule for presentations. So if you check, there are other tutorials on how to arrange a paper or a book or any written material. The best way of sanity checking it is, can people understand what the graph says without having read the article? If yes, good. But, I mean, I don't claim you understand what this graph about My Little Pony is about. But still, you can understand that there is sort of a curve that is best on the other, and you understand what the x and y axis say. Okay? The thing is, you may wonder, if I do put just the graph, why do I need to do that? Because I can refer people to the paper, right? So there is no difference with the paper. Actually, there are some differences. Well, first difference is, of course, that there is you in front of the audience, like explaining in simple terms what the graphs say, which is very important, actually. But besides, you can add things. And one thing you can add is some pictures or photographs to illustrate the situation. Another thing you can add is very, very short comments. I will give some example. And also you can add some summary numbers, which do not fit the normal graph because, well, they are not appropriate for the paper, but they are appropriate for the presentation. The thing is, do not overdo, do not put all of this together. So the example is, of course, if you want to add some more detailed comments, like if you feel like your graph deserves a very detailed explanation, do not put it on the slide. The best thing of doing that would be to add a hidden slide, which works as before, is something that shows up only in print. And when you explain, you say it verbally. Okay? So the example goes like this. If for some reason you are a fan of the show of My Little Pony, you want to explain that these curves are actually three specific characters in the show, then you add the pictures. Something like that. Of course, this is silly, but if you have some networking technology and you want to show, like, you want to show cellular versus Wi-Fi, you add a Wi-Fi router and a cellular phone, it gives you some more descriptive explanation. Or you want to add some complexity, computational complexity measure, which is something that does not go in the figure, in the paper, it goes in the text. So you superimpose this on the figure. Or you might want to add some comparison summary, like you show that the best curve has an 87.3% gain. Okay. This is something you can add, but you see, now the slide is too crowded. There is too much thing. So it's either this is acceptable or this is acceptable, maybe. Okay, so I'm not saying you should add all of these things. You just add one thing, maybe, if you want, and you're not required. Also, to prepare the graph, you need to arrange some compatible format. So this is also very difficult to do. Let's say you have a PDF version of your graph to put in the paper, or you have a PNG, or you have a WMF, it's Windows Meta Format, it's actually what you use from Excel, which I hope you don't do your graph directly from Excel, but sometimes you might have. Okay. Actually, the best thing would be if you did your paper properly via LaTeX, then you probably are advised to do EPS figures. Which anyways, you can easily convert, like EPS is derived from GNUplot or MATLAB or whatever you use, and then you can easily convert them to PDF, and therefore you can put them in the presentation show. Okay, so it's kind of easy to do. The problem is your pictures from the paper are generally not good for the presentation because they are, most of the times they are black and white, and they also have very thin lines. So you should use thick line weights and do not use line markers, but instead use colors. In scientific articles, you generally write in black and white, so you put some markers to distinguish the lines. And this is really ugly for the presentation. To just copy and paste the article from your paper, the picture from your paper, then you have some thin black lines with some markers, which makes definitely sense on paper, but does not make sense on a picture like that, on a graph like that, because you can use colors. Of course, for the colors to be distinguishable, and also for some optical reasons, I'm totally unaware of what the real reason is behind this, but what looks thick printed on paper looks very thin on the screen. So you should really exaggerate with the thickness of your lines. You should make like six times thicker than what you print on paper. Also, you should be careful. If you remember one of the very first slides I mentioned, use dark colors. This is also very true. One immediate choice you want to see many times is, okay, which color should I use? Okay, RGB, red, green, blue. And the green is 100% green, so lime green, which causes you to have one of your three lines that does not display on the screen. So do not use the lime green, if you remember. This means you must manually change the light green to something which is still green but darker. Like MATLAB, for example, does this smart thing. The green used by MATLAB by default is not lime green, but is 76% is 67% green, and zero red and zero blue. And the reason is basically that then people copies the graph on some presentation and nothing displays. But there is nothing more annoying that you show a graph and one of the lines does not display. So you say, okay, this graph beats this other line you can't see. Okay, so be careful that if you use light green or light cyan as well, some projectors do not display them very well. So the best thing would be to use red, which most of the times looks good, blue, also good, black or dark green. And then it depends. But if you, another rule of thumb is that if you are using more than four colors, it means you are more that you have more than four plots, which is something that, well, can happen sometimes because there is no other way of doing that, but it's generally to avoid. So also, but this is also not mentioned here because that's not a rule for presentations. Should be a rule, a general rule for your articles. I hope you don't plan to put generally more than four plots in the same graph. That is too much. If your graph has more than four plots, you better make it two separate graphs. Unless they are like two families of three plots, for example, and you want to compare the two families. But then you don't really have six plots. You can use two different colors, one for one family and another for the other family, right? So it's still a different thing. Generally, you don't need more than four colors. Then one immediate choice could be black, green, dark green, red and blue, okay? And as said, do not use lime green or cyan because, well, here's it, this kind of works. But in other projectors, I'm sure this very presentation, you will see something blurry instead of the lime green. Okay, the thing is, in principle, the graph you show in your PowerPoint is not the same you put on the paper. Because you have to change things. You do not use the markers, or you might use the markers, but they need to be thick, and, well, you don't rely on distinguishing like a triangle from a diamond, for example. That's something good for the printed version, but on the PowerPoint, it does not look very easy to distinguish. So if you're smart, when you arrange the graphs for your paper, you first see that you will have to present it sooner or later, so you make two versions already. That's a smart, the wise thing to do at the beginning. But yeah, it happens that, oh, come on, I didn't think of it. So now I only have the paper version and no version that is good for the projection at the conference. Or maybe, yeah, you didn't do the graphs. Like somebody else did. You had your minions too, which are maybe master students that did the graphs just for their master thesis. They don't care about you presenting at the conference. So what should you do? Well, if you have an EPS figure, which is still black and white, but is vectorial, it is editable. So the best way would be to learn how to edit the EPS. I found this to work very well. So if you have EPS figures where the text is really editable, you can change it. So it works good if you have some, I don't know, master thesis which is written in Italian, and you want, well, with a student permission, to reuse some results. But the results are in Italian, so what do you do? Do you put the graphs with Italian writings or Spanish or whatever writings in the English written paper? No, you don't. So then you have to translate it. So if it is, a PNG, then there is no text. It's just a figure in the shape of text. And you can't edit it. But if it's vectorial, like an EPS, then the text is embedded as text. So you can edit it. And this is one thing you can do. But also, it's actually quite easy to learn meta language, where you have indications on how thick the lines are, what are the colors, and so on. So the thing is, you can edit the figures and make them more colorful and better in appearance for the paper. So you can basically translate from this to that. Okay. this, not for this pony picture, but actually for real graphs. And there is a short tutorial, which I'll give you if I have time, let's see, to show you how can you edit EPS figures. The thing is, it takes forever for now, so I want to show it now. I put it in the extras, which is just following the same suggestion I did for your actual slide sets. I told you, if you have some backup material, just put it at the end of the presentation, and it might be that you have time to show it, or people ask for it. If not, then you don't show it. Still, it works. The point is here is just, if you take your time to see how an actual EPS file is derived, then you will see you can play a bit with the comments, and just change it, the structure a bit, like make lines thicker or change the colors. And this is actually the end of the mandatory content of the presentation. So the message here is just, you have to promise you will follow these advices. And after that, since I still have time, I will discuss optional parts. So the first optional part is how to answer questions after your presentation, which sometimes is harder than doing the presentation. And you might see at certain conferences, you see people which actually you discover after the presentation, they give a very good presentation, and then when questions arise, you understand they just learned by heart everything in the presentation. They repeat it like parrots, and they don't know how to answer. But even simple questions, like maybe they are not English native speakers, which is understandable, and they basically learned the entire presentation, and they recited it over slides without any understanding, which is not what I would advise you to do. So actually, the rule is that you have to have something to say. There is not really required to say something particularly smart or brilliant, but if you, and I'm confident you will, you have done the job yourself. So you have done your homework. You know what the paper is about. You can say something. That's the point here. Don't be afraid of saying something, even if it looks stupid or you don't know how to answer. But it's better to say something than to say nothing. And there is, of course, different levels of better of what to say, but for sure, not saying anything and just panicking is bad. Okay? Of course, so that's the worst answer you can give, no answer at all. Of course, just giving some bad answers is not good and can make the brilliant talk to be bad. That's also a reason to have some backup material. Because in the worst case, you just show up some backup material. You know how to discuss it. Okay? Hoping that this is exactly what they ask for. But still, can save the day to have some backup material. And the other thing is that, again, since we are in a scientific community and all things like that, if you have no alternative, you can give honest answers. There's nothing wrong with that. Even like, if they ask, did you consider this and you didn't, do not lie, do not pretend. Just say, oh, no, we didn't. Thanks for the suggestion. That's actually what conferences are meant for. You're not there to show off that you are the best guy in the world. You're also there to learn and interact with people. So if somebody gives you a suggestion or a constructive criticism, then take it honestly and say, okay, thank you, that's a good idea. We haven't done this. There is no problem saying that, if that's the truth. The thing is, I would advise you not to answer with a lot of fluff and saying things just to take time. That's not honest. Also, remember that if you start discussing things just to waste time, then time is an issue. You have your constrained time slot in the conference. So do not, maybe you stick with your time with the presentation proper, but after that you go in detail for the answer. No, that's not correct. So just give straightforward answers with honesty and simplicity. Okay, another thing you have to do is to listen carefully to the question, which is, honestly, sometimes it's very hard. Because if the guy asking the question speaks a very broken English, maybe you don't understand him or her. So there is no harm in asking him or her to repeat the question. First, make certain that you understood the question, which sometimes, I mean, even after three ARQ repetitions, you won't understand, but still it's something you should try. Also, do not only try to understand the literal question, but try to understand if it is, sometimes it's simply they request you to clarify some tiny detail, which is something you can probably do. Other time is that they want to tell you that you made a mistake, which is a useful comment, just to know. Sometimes is just they want to destroy you, so be prepared. Other times can even be a useful suggestion. So try to understand which is which, because it can be, I mean, your answer should depend on what they want to mean to you. And final thing, sometimes it will happen that they will ask something which is definitely out of your competences. Because, I mean, what they ask for is not the part of the paper you manage. Maybe it's a collaborative work you did with some other fellow of the project or some other PhD student at your university or institution, and you didn't do that specific part, so you don't know what to answer. So, of course, you can tell them to look at the paper or the literature or your colleague that actually did the thing. You can refer them to this, but remember that you are the front man or woman in that precise moment. So do not try to avoid questions. That's something very annoying when people say, oh, I'm presenting this on behalf of my colleague, so, well, I'm presenting it, but don't ask me questions. There's actually something very bad which is also deprecated by most international institutions. I mean, we are all among friends, as I said, so nothing will happen if you see something like that, but officially they should report this kind of behavior, because that's not the correct behavior from the scientific point of view. I go to a conference, I pay even a lot, well, don't pay yours with your pocket money. Your university or institution or enterprise is paying for you, or the project is paying for you, but still people paid some money to see something scientific. So, and conferences are supposed to have people interact. So I advise you strongly against saying, well, don't ask me questions. You should answer the questions. If you did your homework, even it will happen that you were going to present a paper for somebody else's, because, I don't know, your colleague didn't get the visa, or you had five papers at the conference and your boss decided not to send five people and pay five registrations, but they sent only you. And you are a co-author of four of these papers, but the fifth paper, you know nothing. Then you should study the paper before presenting it. Okay, do not go there and just read the slides. You will see a lot of people doing that, which is very bad. Do not do that. Okay. And final thing, final escape from questions is to go offline. You say, okay, maybe you can take this offline. You'll see this a lot. There are also jokes about it. Of course, you can do that, especially if the guy is really hard to convince that you're right and you have a limited time. But do not abuse it. Be sure after the presentation, you can really talk to the guy and convince him you're right. So give it as an honest answer. Also, you can put your email somewhere in the presentation, so then they can bother you by email. That's something that courtesy requires you to do. Okay? Okay, so this is an example of the explanation part taken from an old slide set of mine, which is backup material. It's something I can show you very quickly, but it's something about the original version of how I explain selective repeat ARQ, which is something you might know. Selective repeat ARQ means simply you send a stream of packets and the receiver asks you to retransmit those that it hasn't received correctly. So I send packets and I receive acknowledgement for all packets I send. Whenever I receive a not acknowledgement for a specific packet, I selectively retransmit only that, which is basically what TCP does. Okay? So that's the original version that is on the paper. This is the picture on the paper. And you might be tempted, okay, let's put this very same figure in the slide set. It's a figure. Well, the figure is actually a bit hard to explain because it's black and white, it's not very understandable. Yeah, it is. You can understand there is a block schematon, but it's not really appealing. So what I did in the presentation I had was to add some colorful animation. And the colorful animation is, as said, you had a transmitter sending data and the receiver sending acknowledgments back. So this green means it is an acknowledgement because the packet went through correctly. If there is a red block, meaning the packet didn't arrive correctly, you send a non-acknowledgement, and then you ask for a transmission. Okay, that's what it's all about. And also, everything is received back at the transmitter side after a round trip time. That's what you need to explain, right? So to explain that, I showed like this, with an animation in the figure. You have a queue at the transmitter side sending packets to the receiver. So you see, I didn't check that this doesn't display well. Okay, you send packets, and packets are received at the channel. If the channel receives them correctly, like green, then it's okay, and it's sent in a buffer. And you send back an acknowledgement. If the packet instead is wrong, you see it becomes red and it's corrupted, then you ask for a retransmission with a non-acknowledgement. And the last thing you want to explain is that retransmissions have priority, so you wait before retransmitting new packets, before transmitting new packets, you send forward retransmissions. Okay? You see the animation and it's still not perfect because I didn't check that the background was too dark in this version, actually, in this projector. It's something it takes time for you to arrange, to show the same thing, which if you're lazy, you can just do that. You can take the copy and paste from the paper, which is this, which is, well, decent, it's not wrong, but it's ugly to explain at a conference, right? And instead you do some animations and it takes time and you have to check them and something goes wrong, but still it gives you a better understanding of what to do. And this is a tutorial I was talking about before, about graph editing, which is also backup material. The thing is, if you use EPS, this is also can be seen as an application layer language. So again, it has preamble plus body. So the thing is, you just check what the preamble says and you tune everything to it. So you can edit from a text editor. It's just like learning a programming language and edit its code. Especially, this is an example. This is actually the EPS of the previous figure I showed. If you try opening it with a text editor, you see this line of comments in the EPS made by GNUplot. You see that there are some flags that can be edited by hand. And these flags are color and black text. And also there are other parameters that you might change, but do not change them. That's not advisable. Okay, so this is the figure you would have on a paper. If you print this, it displays very well. And also, you have different lines. So from a paper perspective, you can distinguish them very well. Also, you don't pay for color figures in your paper, so you make your advisor happy. So that's what you would put on a paper. And you see, it's different from what I showed you before, and it's not very readable from a presentation point of view. If you present this at the conference, everybody thinks, okay, come on, this guy is lazy. There is no way I can understand this. It's boring, and I don't really distinguish the lines properly. Okay, so first thing, you can set the color flag to true. If you do so, you see, you have colors now. But now the figure is even worse because the lines are still thin and they are colors, so they're even worse to distinguish. So you then go inside the GNUplot or MATLAB, depending on how you derive them, and change the line width, which in GNUplot is this UL command, unit line, And in MATLAB is this W command, which stands for width.
We just make them
thicker.
Like from,
change the number like this. Try and error, but it works.
Also, you might change dashes, markers, colors. There are some ways of doing that. And there is no tutorial about that because it's best if you try yourself and even make your hand dirty with this gameplay. I think you can do it. It's something like back engineer, reverse engineering some code.
So if you play it a bit, it's really easy to do. You basically change from this to that, which is what we had earlier. And this is kind of acceptable. You see, I also changed that certain lines are dashed, certain others are not.
I still left the markers.
And the reason I left, why I left the markers is that, you see, the colors are not very different. I could have made them better without the need for markers if I used different colors, like black, red, and blue, which are easier to distinguish. So it, up to your taste. So there is, I'm not saying there is one possibility only.
The thing is, definitely you have thicker lines and also darker colors.
Okay, so another useful suggestion, similar to this were for poster presentations. Because sometimes you send a paper to a conference and they say, okay, your paper is accepted, but for poster presentation. And so what should I do? So many people simply print their PowerPoint and they attach the 15 slides to the board. Which is, come on, a bit lazy. You can do that, but you can also do a real poster. The trick would be prepare a big poster, and then either you go around with a tube, for containing posters, or the best trick would be to bring it to a copy shop somewhere. If you are attending the conference in a university, for sure there are some copy shops close to the university, so you go there and have them printed. It's kind of cheap, and I guess you can put them on some refunding. More than going around with the tube that the low-cost companies do not like. They make you store in the overhead compartment or wherever. You don't know where to put them, right? They are oversized. But again, I mentioned this, the poster presentation, because it's actually similar to what I discussed for a conference presentation. Because you can use, again, PowerPoint presentation to do a poster. You can use PowerPoint to prepare your presentation. You simply set a single slide with a custom size, like 50 times 70, depending on what the specifics for the poster are. Again, you split the organization of your poster in three parts. First, motivation, then explanation, and finally, graphs. It's something you can do, also for the poster. The trick is also for the poster, most of the content must be graphical. So it's actually very much the same as the presentation, the normal presentation for a PowerPoint set, because you need to interact with people with a double channel. One is you and the other one is what they see in the printout. There are some advantages actually, because in a poster, more than in a presentation with normal screen in PowerPoint, you are more flexible in space. You do not have a single slide, so you can be more flexible. You can put some comments over the border of the single slide. Also, you don't need to bother any time to check in logos and animations and everything. You just do things at the beginning and then you're set. Also, you don't need much overhead, because if you structure a poster, then the structure is more or less self-evident. You don't need to say, okay, now the explanation starts, and now the numerical results start. People can see them by themselves. If they see graphs, they understand there is a numerical result. They see all of them at once, right? There are actually some problems. First, most important problem is that you can't use animations. You have to invent something smarter. Also, it is difficult to understand how to read the poster. So you must be very careful and to
use some strategy to make it self-evident whether the paper is, the poster is to be read left to right or top to bottom. For example, you can make three bands, top to down, with motivation, explanation, and results at the end, for example. And within it, everything is left to right. Okay, this is easy to understand then. But anyways, the poster is less sequential, because now in this presentation, I decide what you have to see first and what you have to see second. In a poster, people can ask you something, oh, I see you have this result here. Can you explain me this result? Even before they hear the motivations. Okay, so this also means a poster should be catchy everywhere. Not only just give a catchy beginning where you motivate your problem and then maybe the results are a bit weak, but who cares? People have understood that you tackled an interesting problem. Well, with the poster, you have to give them some nice results. So it's actually more difficult sometimes. And finally is that a temptation that you might have with the poster is that, okay, I have so much space, so why don't I use it for putting a lot of formulas? Because then it's written, I just copy the formulas from the paper. Well, do not do that, because unless, again, you want to show off that you did a lot of math, then you are advised against using a lot of formulas in your paper. In your poster, sorry. The thing is that in a poster presentation, I don't know if you've ever been involved in one, but you will sooner or later, there are a lot of people passing by, and they are more casual attendees than even for a conference presentation. In an oral presentation, there are people who check the conference program. They went to your session because they want to hear something about your topic of research. So they are competent, they know about it, and they, okay, let's hear to this guy. Maybe they went for another paper, so they don't want to hear explicitly from you, but still, they generally, in good conferences, the topic of papers in the same sessions, in the same session, are similar. With posters, it might be you have a long corridor filled with posters, and you are just beside somebody with a very interesting topic, so, and people see you and, oh, let's hear what this guy has to say. Maybe you look nice, or so there is a professor that falls in love with you and say, oh, let's hear what this guy or girl has to say. And they just ask you just to be kind, or because you look attractive, whatever. But things is, they do not come specifically for you, which means that these people really need an even lower layer explanation than the guys from an oral presentation. You really need to give them a very simple explanation, and generally this means that you don't give them formulas. So there are some tricks that, so first thing you have to do is make clear to them what the paper is about. That's the most important thing. If they are interested, then they stay, otherwise they say, okay, no, I don't know anything about the topic, they go away. There are some tricks you can do. One thing I tend to do, if I have time, is I print some copies of the paper. Because generally for a conference presentation, they come to the session prepared. For a poster, they just see you and they want to know what the paper is about. You have to explain them. If they are interested, then you can hand them a printed copy of the paper, so they can read the paper while you present. Because for a conference, then nowadays, you just see people in the audience that if they want to see more on the paper, they just check the online proceedings of the conference while you talk, and they look at your graphs in the paper. So you can even real-time refer them to the paper. But for a poster, it's like somebody coming like this, yeah, tell me about your paper. And maybe you want to catch his or her attention. After you did, you want to refer them to some formulas. but you don't put the formulas on the paper. So you just send them to the printed copy you hand them. Okay. The thing is, generally posters have a lot of interactions, but most of them are for people just casual passerbys. So the idea is that people want to exchange ideas, wants to know what's about, and also they want just to maybe to hand their business cards to you. So be kind in this case, be gentle, but do not be mistaken. This is not sincere interest, it's just that they're there and they want to be kind. So be ready to even frustrating explanations where you explain things very patiently and they don't understand the thing. Because they weren't there to learn for a specific paper. Apart from that, the rest is more or less similar to what I explained to you for normal conference. Okay, so you can keep the same rules of thumb, big text, big fonts. Also, you want simple messages, maybe graphical descriptions of what you did, and also catchy motivations and everything. That's always true. Okay, so now, basically, I'm about to conclude. In reality. So we have some samples of good and bad slides. So you can tell me, well, that's actually very easy, very simple, but you can tell if these slides are good or bad. So the first rule is actually there is no general rule to say a slide is good or bad. You can have a very good graph that if put out of context will be very bad. Okay, so there is a difference that is quite subtle. You can have a projector that messes up with your colors, or maybe you were sure this picture was portable, but actually the projector or the computer changes the fonts, or maybe you know how Windows works, so sometimes things go wrong without you doing explicitly anything. Okay, also it can well be that you are presenting and in the middle of everything the computer decides to, well, reset or update Windows, whatever. So it can happen. So of course, it's only 99% sure, it's not 100% sure. You need to rehearse and check the slides, and even if you check them, something can go wrong anyways, like before. But still, this, I would say, is a kind of good graph, so it's Pinkie Pie approved, because you have three distinguishable lines. You understand what is, you basically understand whatever the algorithm says. You understand that you do better than the competitors. Okay? And this is instead a bad graph. Of course this is bad, but why is it bad? Reasons why the graph is bad? More than four lines. Other reasons? Yeah, there are, the key of the graph is superimposed to some lines. Actually, this is still somehow it's not entirely bad because I put the line over the key, but still it's bad. Of course, you don't want that. Other reasons? Sorry? Yeah, the lines are too thin. Other reasons? There are markers. Other reasons? There are a lot of bad reasons. So why do you think this is bad also? Other reasons is that gamma... No title depends. That the title is bad graph. But of course, there would be a title at least in the title of the slide. True? Yeah, alpha and beta are bad for... alpha, beta, and gamma are bad for two reasons. One thing is that you shouldn't write alpha in Latin letters. You should use the symbol alpha, at least, or beta or gamma. And also, what are they? You don't know. So instead of just writing alpha, you should write whatever it is. Let's say, energy parameter of the battery alpha. Okay? So a descriptive name. Other reasons? I would say another reason is that line gamma equal to 3 and gamma equal to 6 are both red lines, which is bad, because if for some reason you want to distinguish, say, as you see, The red line describes instability, whatever it is, because you see beta goes too high. What is the red line? There are two red lines. So unless they have the same behavior, because it might be you have two lines that go very high and they explode, whatever they mean, and then you put both of them in red. If not, like this, actually, gamma equal to 3 does not go uphill. It's just gamma equal to 6 that has the behavior. So, and the best way of referring to a line is, again, not to use the laser pointer, but to say, as you see in the red line, but there are two red lines. Well, plus there are two bad red lines because they use a very thin thickness, and also they use markers that are difficult to distinguish, because one is a filled dot and the other one is an empty dot. But yeah, come on, you can do better. Just put one of them red and the other black, so you don't risk this. Also, even though, again, this is a good projector and it distinguished them, but gamma equal to 4 and gamma equal to 5.25 are green and cyan, colors to avoid, like a disease. Also, another bad thing of this graph is, well, why do we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.25, and 6? Looks more natural you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Right? Unless there is some special meaning in these numbers, there is no reason not to use an equally spaced base. And as said, of course, if you use an equally spaced base step, then you don't need 6 curves. Right, because more or less, well, sort of, you can interpolate the behavior, right? You can guess that the behavior of 5 is between 4 and 6. So that line is really useless. Just to show something to the people. Okay? So there are several reasons why a graph can be ugly and bad. But also, this can be a bad graph. I mean, that's the same graph as two slides before, but you see that you add some comments. So say very same graph, but for some reason you feel the graph is not explanatory, and you need to add some comments some silly comments like, you see that pink line is best. Why do you need to do that? There's no need to do that. You say it yourself. So if you do that, that's also bad, because if you integrate it with text, remember that you somehow admit that your graph is not self-explanatory. And if your graphs are good, and this also true for the paper, your graph should be self-explanatory by itself. Because remember that, let's say, 50% of the reviewers will look at the abstract, maybe they read the introduction, they jump to the graph and say, oh, this guy did something interesting. They have some nice results. So that's another, independently of the presentation, that's a very good reason to have self-explanatory graphs. If you add some text in the presentation, it means that you are not confident enough your graph is self-explanatory, so you better improve your graph instead of adding text. Okay? And so, summary of the advices I wanted to give you. Short sentences. Do not write too much. Use big fonts. Do not squeeze text. Every time you see PowerPoint starting decreasing the paragraph interline, is decreasing the font size, whatever, just start a new slide. Of course, remember you have a limited number of slides. And also, do not worry if your slide looks too empty. There is no need to fill them with dumb things like clip arts or explanatory things unless it's really needed. I think I've seen one of the best presentations I've seen was a colleague in Sweden, a colleague that did basically, he was very good at talking, so he was very interactive with the audience. But he did a 20-minute presentation with just 5 slides, and those 5 slides had like 3 lines of text each. So not much. But there was a nice graph where he showed he did a really good improvement of the state of the art. And he motivated it very quickly. Like, at the time it was like 3G taking off, so said, okay, 3G is a new, so showed at the beginning some strong motivation about the need for 3G was then, and then some description of simply what they did as an approach without any question. And then they show, and this, he said, of course, if you want to know more, read the paper. And finally, he concluded with, okay, this is the main result we got, which is something that sometimes happens, sometimes does not. It very much depends on the paper, right? In certain cases, you're lucky, you get a huge improvement with little effort, and then you are have enough for one publication. Sometimes, other times, you have to do a lot of results to interpret the goodness of your approach. So it's not always possible. But if it is, then you do not need to add more results to prove you did a good job. Okay? And you should avoid this, like doing a lot of text where you go with a very tiny font until the end. You have really designed, there are a lot of things you shouldn't do listed. Okay, so this is another bad example of organizational slide. Okay? And so also to avoid is to use multiple colors, also the dot over there is different, or different fonts or different formats. Don't do that because it looks like a patchwork and it's not very consistent. Also avoid clip arts. That's something I already mentioned. It's also true that you shouldn't use this kind of symbols because, yeah, these symbols, I think I put them, I can show you my previous version of the slide set. I think some of the symbols changed, so are winding symbols, and they somehow change it because, well, every version of Windows has its own different set of windings things. So if you check my previous version, those are different symbols. Every time I change the format of PowerPoint or the computer, these symbols are nicely changed and they become something else. Also, remember that you need to print your PowerPoint in the end, so beware of overlapping text with pictures. And also, try to be consistent, try to avoid typos. Of course, there will be something, like your English won't be perfect. The important thing is it hasn't been approved by the Queen. At least it must be understandable. Of course, we are all among internationals, so we don't need a perfectly fluent English, both in writing and speaking. But at least be careful not to have some strange typo or do some mistake that leads to, I mean, some undertext that is better to avoid. Okay? And finally, avoid something that is distracting, even though they're fun. Avoid using something that steer the audience attention from your technical content, because at least for us, this is not a scientific method, so I'm allowed to use some surprise guy, a reaction guy or so, but do not do that for a scientific presentation, because in the end you want people to remember, okay, maybe they want, you want them to remember your presentation, but not because you were extremely funny, but because you did some good exposition and some good technical job. Okay, and that's all for real now. Okay? Okay, and then I'll take some questions of you if you have, because we have time, I think.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. 20 minutes for questions.
Yeah?
Sorry. So, any question? Don't be shy.
Even, I mean, I understand that even if you have everything clear, you can ask me, I don't know, debate. Most of the things I said are subjective. They are not like absolute truth. So you might disagree with me. You might, it's just meant to give you suggestions, which save you to learn this the hard way, like watching a lot of bad presentations where these things are not respected, and do this yourself. But if you have comments like, what should I do in this case? Or I don't agree with you with this point. I think that can be also, there can be other ways of doing things. I might even agree. Feel free to express yourself here in this sense.
Sorry.
with the recording.
Okay, thank you. Should I get up?
Just for the recording.
Okay, well, first of all, I think that this was a very nice and very useful presentation. And although you said not to take this as a golden rules or as the like fundamental rules, I think that there's very good hints. And it seems that you are very experienced in this kind of events. And I wonder, you have mentioned before about the people who are in the conferences asking you, instead of asking you questions, which from my point of view would be the correct way to be in a conference, they are just trying to point out errors in your presentations. And I wonder, well, what is the motivation behind this, and how often does it happen?
No, it doesn't happen very often, don't worry. The thing is, it very much depends on how you put yourself in danger into your presentation. So the other way of avoiding that would be to be humble, which doesn't mean to keep your tone low. You can be brilliant without being too much arrogant and claim you have the solution for everything. The important thing is that to be careful. Like I remember, I think one paper I wrote with Marco, we basically were claiming that an algorithm, a known routing algorithm for ad hoc network, was could be improved. And when I was at the conference, I had sitting in first row the author of that algorithm, which is some, then I say, okay, there is this algorithm which is very famous and everything. So, and he was actually amused. He said, oh, good job and everything. So if you start from the beginning saying, okay, this algorithm is wrong and I'm going to show you how to correct it, for sure he will rise and say, okay, but you consider different version, and it depends. So it very much depends on how you put it. And sometimes it happens because not all people attending conferences are nice. Don't be scared anyways, because also, on the other hand, people do not want to stay in the conference for too long. So it's not the moment for pointless debates. It can happen, but most of the times it's becoming more and more common. There are a lot of conferences, and people attending the conferences do not have time to watch everything. So they just go there, they give you some kind courtesy questions most of the times, and you do not need to worry about their questions. So it might be they didn't have understood what you said fully. It might be they just want to, they are related somehow to what you did. Also, one reason to try to bash the speaker could be that they think your contribution is too simple. So in this case, is best, my advice would be to keep, raise your hand and say, okay, look, this is a preliminary contribution. I'm not claiming this is the ultimate solution. And if you don't do that, they might think, okay, look, this guy got away with a publication on this idea, which is actually very simple. And I want to destroy him now because I'm envious that he got this published while I got rejected. That's one thing that can happen. But it doesn't happen very often. And in any event, you don't have to worry because nobody's touching your publication, first of all. And second, you are there to interact scientifically, not to fight or anything. So stay out of every nasty remark, which can happen. Just be prepared to everything. It can be they didn't understand your point there. Maybe they want to show off or whatever, but don't worry. Again, the only way of answering wrong for sure is to panic and get into, I don't know what to say, I didn't mean to say that. Just stay straight and answer calmly and everything will be fine. The thing is, generally, 90% of the times, people asking you questions do not understand what the paper is about. They just do it because they don't see any questions from the audience, or the chairman is supposed maybe to ask you some questions, not to leave you silent afterwards. That's not always the case. And so in this case, you can answer whatever you say. That's good. Just be careful that you might be in the 10% of the cases where the guy really knows what you're doing and he's giving very useful suggestions, So do not lose that. Do not start answering like casually. Just pay sincere attention to what he's saying. So that's my suggestion. I want, if you behave properly, and plus there are other attendees. So if there is some nasty guy, sometimes there are some nasty guys who want to show off and say, oh, I think you made a mistake there and the approach is wrong and your approach is unoriginal and whatever, then it's most likely that other people in the room will say, okay, this guy is really, well, bad, so to say. They won't say anything at you. They will say at the guy who is in the question. So don't worry. But still, do not expect much from the interaction after the presentation. Most of the interesting interactions will take place afterwards, maybe because you have maybe a specific question, but it's so specific you don't raise your hand and ask questions immediately afterwards. You ask questions like at the social dinner, for example. So it is important if you raise some interest, at least at the level of I have some contributions on this specific topic. It might be the topic itself is important, or your idea is nice without being particularly debatable, or there might be something which is worth discussing. Whatever it is, you better discuss this with the right people at the conference. But I still am confident that you can get something out of this.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Some question from people connected.
No questions. We are we are not that ahead of schedule because we started late. So yes.
Hello. I would like to ask, have some tips on the introduction. How much to, when you introduce the first slide that you mm-hmm. do, then how much do you cover of the things that you are doing? How do you structure it in the introduction? Or do you just skim over it very fast and get right to the point?
Well, I understand the point. There is no rule here because it very much depends on the audience and also the introduction you receive from the chairman of the session. It's generally good to be prompt and adapt yourself to the situation because first thing, it might be that certain chairmen, when introducing you, they already say everything. Like they say, oh, we have Mr. or Miss blah, blah, blah from university or from this corporation, and he will present this paper or she will present this paper about this and that. So I guess, maybe sometimes they say, so I guess your paper is about this and that, and they start saying things themselves. So if so, it's kind of pointless to repeat from the beginning, so my paper is on this and that. If they don't say anything and they say, okay, now next speaker is name and family name from this country, and that's the title, and that's it, then you better say some words yourself about what you're discussing. Like, I'm from this university, and this, or from this institution, and this is the topic of my presentation is about this. Especially if this is like different from the previous talk, then you mention there is a change of topic, something like that. But there is no rule. I mean, it's best if you prepare something to say about it, but also get ready not to say it, because it might be there is no need for saying that. But the generally advice is, but this is not a golden advice anyway, by any means. You should say almost nothing at the beginning, and you just give a good introduction after the outline, because this is the best point where to catch the attention about the topic. But it's really a matter of style. Also, it very much depends on the presentation. If you have a very narrow topic you want to challenge, then you better explain to the audience a bit what it is before starting. If your topic is like the need for energy harvesting in wireless communication, this is something which is more understandable and you don't explain it too much. So it very much depends. There is no real answer here. And I wouldn't say it's very much depending on the circumstances. I would advise to be ready to adapt yourself. This is also true for just saying your name, because I generally advise my students, even for their simple presentation, like the bachelor or thesis presentation, to introduce themselves at the beginning. So to say, okay, my name is, I work with Professor X, and I do this and that. But if the chairman says this already, do not repeat it. So just start from your, without the introduction part, just start from already in media re from the beginning of things. Okay, so this, the best suggestion I can give you is to be adaptive. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other question? So we can have on time the break. Many thanks, Leonardo, for the very interesting presentation.
Thank you.